Good morning, church.
Good morning. I'd
like to welcome all of you to our worship service today on this fifth and final Sunday in the month of October. To all of you here in the sanctuary, welcome, as well as those who are joining with us in the cafe church behind me and those who are joining in online and your television at home. Welcome to our service today. As we get started, I have just a few announcements to share with you regarding our life together. First, you know, this last Thursday, I just want to share with the whole congregation that our senior advocate ministry hosted a wonderful costume luncheon for members of our church, including close to 20 of our more homebound members and friends. And everybody did a great job. I'm grateful for your commitment to keeping these connections, you know, vital to these important members of our church, the decorations, the meals, you know, the costumes, the treats, the gifts, your hospitality was all wonderful. So thank you all very much. And if anyone would like to learn a little bit more about this ministry, please speak with myself or our lay leader, Eve Hoffman. Our women's prayer group continues to meet, you know, on Wednesday mornings at 9:30. It meets here in the sanctuary. It's a time of prayer and praise and fellowship. All women of the church are welcome. Also, people have an opportunity to explore their more creative side and share in some laughter and fun this Thursday at 10 a.m. in the parish hall. All are welcome to make floral arrangements, which you can take home, or you can share with someone, or you can donate to the thrift shop and Christmas room that will be opening up in a few weeks. Materials will be provided, but feel free to bring any items you'd like to use or share with others. If you have any questions, please contact Janet Snow. The work on the fisherman's house continues. It's quite a transformation, isn't it, church?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah, we thank all the trustees for their leadership on this project and everyone who's donated to the memorial fund. That's an important piece in this. If you've made a donation in memory and honor of a loved one, a congregation member over the years, these monies also helped make this project possible. 1 week from today, right, so not, you know, 1 week from today, next Sunday, during our communion service, we'll be recognizing members and friends of our congregation who have died during the past year. It's part of our All Saints Day celebration, so their names will be read and a bell will be rung. Family members will be invited to light a memorial candle, and you know, you all know that's a very important service and a meaningful one. Opportunity to honor and give thanks for the lives of those who have blessed our own, sometimes very directly and immediately and sometimes very indirectly. But all have blessed us. We encourage people to come. Also on Tuesday, November 15th, we're having our annual all-church conference. This will be held at 6:30 p.m. in our parish hall. The Reverend Rodney Dobbs of the Northside United Methodist Church will be presiding. We'll review our ministry of the past year, vote on the pastor's salary, receive reports from the nominating committee, the trustees, the pastor, the finance committee, and review our membership. The agenda is embedded in experience of worship and end with Holy Communion. You all are welcome to come. Now, as of last Thursday, we received 47 pledges to support our life and ministry together in 2023. We thank all of you who've made a pledge, but we know that there are still pledges out there, pledges that haven't come in. So if you would like to make a pledge, to make things easier, we put a pledge card and an envelope in our bulletins today. No pledge is too big or too small, right? Every single pledge, no matter the size, makes a difference and impacts our life together. And so, please, if you'd like to pledge and haven't yet, just fill out the card. You can place it in the offering plate but we're grateful for everyone's commitment and generosity. And remember, in celebration of the conclusion of our annual stewardship campaign, and as a way of saying thank you to everyone, there's going to be a luncheon after worship. It's free. It's in the parish hall. It's put on by members and friends of your stewardship and finance committee. So everyone's welcome to stay for this meal, an opportunity to enjoy some additional fellowship. The final announcement I have is we want to always make sure that our visitors are welcome with us. We thank you for joining with us for worship, and we're blessed to have you here with us today. Let's continue the spirit of worship as we listen to the prelude that Cameron has prepared and as the ushers light our altar candle. Continue in the spirit of worship by joining together in the call to worship. We invite all who are able to stand for this moment of the sermon. Trusted guide, you are our mentor and our inspiration.
Our home with your choices and decisions.
Please gather your wisdom around us.
Guide us carefully as we make our choices.
Teach us how to hear your voice.
And to attend to our wisdom in those around us.
Guide of our lives, reveal our spiritual path.
And direct us in the living of it.
Let us stand and remain standing and sing, Rejoice, the Lord is King, number 715.
Thank you. thy moment's silence. God,
please bless those who waited with us, who labored with us, and who cried out with us. Bless those who knew our limits, who pushed us beyond them, and who saw us through into a new day. Bless those who called us to our strengths, who tended to us in our weakness, and who dressed each ragged wound. Bless those who laughed in the face of convention, who wept for our own pain, and who bid us to come and live.
Please bless them, Lord,
and in gratitude, help us to see how we can do and be the same for others. In your holy name we pray.
Amen.
I knew that I made a difference by helping my students year after year. In 2015, though, everything changed. I was working with autistic students who could become violent due to their frustrations and needs. I sustained 3 hits to the head in 1 week and was diagnosed with a TBI, a traumatic brain injury. My teaching career was over, and it took some time to heal. I had many questions, but I wondered, how could I serve? What could I do to help others now? It took some time to move forward, it always does. I found I could write when I still had difficulty speaking. And then, We found all of you here through the beach service. And what I know now is that there are so very many ways to serve. You can give monetary gifts if you're able, and that is important. But there are so many other things we all can do. So know that if one door closes, another door, another path to service will open. A few years ago, I never would have dreamed that I would be doing PowerPoint slides each week. We don't know where God will lead us, but He will lead us. And He led us here, and I'm so very, very glad.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I myself was attracted here to the church through the beach service. She dragged me there. I was not a church person ever until now. But when we went to the beach service, one of the times we were there, the equipment failed. And Pastor John's voice didn't get out. And that was really important to me. So I went up and asked if I could help. And then I met Howard Eaton. And Howard taught me how to basically do this work. And working with it, you know, became challenging, but it's rewarding. It really is rewarding to do this. After Howard passed away, Pastor John asked me if I would do the work, and I agreed to, and I'm glad. Thank you very much for asking. Okay. So one of the things is, when we read the scripture, which we're going to read next, the next to the last sentence that we hear is, the word of God for the people. Which is very important. It's important that the word of God get out. What we do with this video is we take this video, we send the word of God out through it. We put it on Channel 99, our local TV station here. We put it up on the web so you can see it there. And it's up on YouTube so people can hear it there. So what we want to do is we want to reach more people. And we can do this by doing an email chain. Now, with an email chain is where, when I send the video up to YouTube, they send me a link. And I can take that link and I can email it to anybody I want to. So what we would like to do is email everybody in the church a link. Then you can take that link and you can forward it to anybody you want to forward it to. And then they can forward it. You can forward it to as many people as you can. I know some people aren't email savvy on how to forward and stuff. But if you ever have any problems, I'm here. I can help you out a little bit. So you can do that. And so when you do send the email, what we'll do, we'll send it here from the church so that you know it's a good email and it's not coming from some place that is trying to scam or spam or any of that stuff. Then you can send it up, like I said, to your friends and your family and anybody, even people who don't even go to church. Maybe let's start going. It's important. So I'll end this by saying the very last thing we say after we read the scriptures, thanks be to God. And hopefully this works, and it's an experiment, and it's going to be good. Thank you.
Thank you, Donna and Jim. That was wonderful. The scripture reading this morning is from 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 1 through 7. Would you all please stand as you read for the reading? Salutations. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, for the sake of the promise of life that is in Jesus Christ. To Timothy, my beloved child, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I am grateful to God, whom I worship with a clear conscience as my ancestors did, when I remember you constantly in my prayers day and night, recalling your tears. I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that lived first in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and now I am sure lives in you. For this reason, I remind you to rekindle the gift of God that is within you through the laying on of my hands. For God did not give us a spirit of cowardice, but rather a spirit of power and of love and of self-discipline. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated.
Good morning. Where is Pastor John? That's the question. You lost it before I could ask it. Glad to see you all this morning. I hope you had a great week. It's good to see you. I was thinking when Miss Lisa was reading that scripture about grandmothers and mothers passing their faith on, you all have grandmothers here today, so isn't that cool, huh? So where do you think, I don't know what happened to Pastor John. He does this to me a lot. We'll be somewhere and all of a sudden I look around and he's gone and he didn't tell me where he was going. And I don't know. Anybody guess where he went? Yes. Who do you think this is?
Hi.
You think it's Pastor John? I don't know. It's like...
I hope I don't run into the big bad wolf. Have you seen the big bad wolf ever?
No.
Have you seen the big bad wolf?
That's
my
dog.
That's my dog. That's good. He's really not a big bad wolf, is he?
Does that suit even feel comfy?
It feels very comfy. Yes. So you know the story of Little Red Riding Hood. Why would Pastor John come to church dressed up as Little Red Riding Hood today?
Because
why dress up in costume today? Yes, that's right, Blaze, because tomorrow is Halloween. Yes.
On Friday I carved pumpkins at my school.
You carved pumpkins at your school? Oh, that's something that we do for Halloween.
To count how much seeds we got.
What's that?
We're going to carve pumpkins today.
All right. Are any of you going to dress up at all?
Yes. No.
No. Yes, we have some yeses and some noes. What will you dress up to be?
A koala.
No, koala. A koala. Oh, there's a difference there. It's Cruella de Vil. Yes, another character from a tale. Yes. Are you going to dress up?
As
Mirabelle.
From Harry
Potter. Oh, yes. And anybody else? Not you. No, you're not going to dress up?
No.
Are you going to go around and visit people? Going to have a party? No. Okay. Are you going to? Blaze, you're going to dress up. Yeah. What are you going to dress up?
Captain America.
Captain, that's right. You told me last week, Captain America. Ooh, yes.
We also have school on Friday. We also have Halloween.
Nice. Yeah, sometimes people dress up to celebrate Halloween, right? And that can be a lot of fun, putting on a wig or a red, right, riding hood or cape. Or having a basket, or putting on a mustache, or so on. So it can be kind of fun to
have
to put on things.
It's very
cheap. Isn't it cheap? Yeah. But it can be fun, right? Yes, and then you become like this different character, right, for a little while. And when I thought about putting on clothes, right, a costume, I was reminded of some words in the Bible. And I want to read them to you. And these are from a letter. It's like a letter that you would maybe receive or send to somebody else. It was a letter that someone named Paul sent to a church a long, long time ago. And this is what he said. As God's people, holy and loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Support each other, and if anyone's upset with something another did, forgive them, for God has forgiven you. And above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds everything together in a perfect way. and be thankful. When I thought about these words, as Paul says that, you know, when we are kind or not kind, it's a choice we're making. Just like a choice that Pastor John made to put on this little Red Riding Hood outfit, right? It's something that literally I've put on. And similarly, if you are going to be kind or not be kind, it's just a choice or decision you make. You can make a decision every day to be kind or not to be kind. Just like you decide what clothes you're going to put on and wear on any day. You can make a decision to be generous and share what you have or not. You can choose to be a friend to someone else or not. And it's like putting on your clothes each day. And so Paul is reminding us to not only put on the clothes that we wear on any day or maybe a costume we wear for Halloween, but to put on these important ways of living. Put on kindness, Isabel. Put on generosity, Philip. Put on gentleness, Liz. Put on love, Jaden. Put on forgiveness, Haley. All those things and more you and I can do, and it makes a difference in our lives and the lives of others. What we choose to clothe ourselves with every day. So thank you for helping me share this message to remind each other to clothe ourselves with love every day. And it's something that you and I do as intentionally as the clothes we put on and don't choose to put on when we start our day. And have fun this weekend and be safe tomorrow. God bless you all. As we continue with the service, and as a little wardrobe change takes place, I invite us all to stand and sing our next hymn. Congregation.
name is Margaret. I'm grateful that Peggy's daughter, Jane, is here with us today. Peggy celebrated her 94th birthday last month, just in September. And she died 3 weeks ago to this very day. She and her husband, Edward, joined our congregation when they moved here to the Cape in 1970. So Peggy had been a member of this church for 52 years. I shared during the service that Peggy was a woman of deep faith. I trust a number of you remember her. She was born and raised in Maryland. Her parents were Methodists. Peggy was Methodist all her life. She had a degree in music, loved playing the piano, especially hymns, while others would sing along. She met her husband of 69 years at a Methodist youth fellowship meeting where she was playing the piano for the group. He was getting ready to start medical school. Peggy's love of music, her family, and her faith seemed to have been the pillars upon which she built her life. In her younger years here at our church, Peggy not only attended worship faithfully, participated in many of our activities and aspects of our life together, she came became especially involved in our Christian education program. She taught Sunday school, was a superintendent of our church school program for a time. Back in those days, our church had a few more children than we have today. I heard someone tell me this past week that just one class of two grades could have like 22 children. Peggy served on the Education Commission and gave of her time and talent in many, many important ways. And after I offered the meditation, the reflection, during the service we sang a hymn, then we opened up the service, invited family members and friends and congregation members, if they wanted to stand where they were and just share a brief word of thanks or a memory or a story, in honor of the gift of Peggy's life. One member of our congregation stood up to speak, Carol Livingston, who has been a member of this congregation herself for, a few decades. And Carol beautifully shared how she appreciated the way Peggy mentored younger members of the congregation, especially in the area of Christian education. Carol said Peggy had a wonderful way of looking out for members newer to teaching, offering them guidance and support. Lisa DeVell was also one of those individuals from our congregation who benefited from being able to work with Peggy. Lisa, you said you too learned a lot from her, right? You taught fifth and sixth grade class together. So I called Carol up earlier this past week to ask her permission to share some of what she passed on to those present for the service with all of you today, because it was part of the day that really inspired me. And Carol went on to say that she feels this is an important aspect of being part of the church. We encourage each other along our way, which sometimes means inviting each other into roles and opportunities for service, even ones we ourselves might not yet feel ready for. She went on to say her family was very involved in the life of the congregation. She had relationships with people of all ages, and this intergenerational experience was a gift and a blessing in her life. Her relationship with Peggy was one example of this. Carol, under the encouragement of people like Peggy and others, became a Sunday school teacher herself, went on to become the superintendent of Sunday school. Peggy clearly had a deep love for the Lord and a desire to share this love with others. She not only did this herself, but she invited others like Carol, Lisa, to do the same, which they too have been doing beautifully for years. You see how like these gifts are just passed on from one to another. I didn't know all of what Jim and Donna were going to say, but did you hear who helped Jim with the work he's doing right now? Who was it?
Howard.
A year ago, Howard was still with us. You know, another way these gifts have been passed on, another example. You know, Jane, I know that there are many gifts, right, that your mother passed on to you and for which you're grateful. And can I share the two that you shared with me? When I asked Jane that question, I met with her before the service, along with one of her brothers and your husband, Frank. Jane said the two gifts she received from her mother that were most important were unconditional love and faith. Powerful gifts. Just a couple days after this, you know, really meaningful memorial service in honor of Peggy, I was on the phone with an adult daughter of another member of our congregation, someone who attended our senior advocate's costume luncheon. I shared a little bit about that with all of you at the start of our service. This luncheon was this past Thursday, and while talking with this adult daughter over the phone, she honestly shared with me some of the challenges that she'd been facing recently, health-wise and family-wise, and how it can get to be a lot, especially when you're also caring for an aging parent in your home. She then shared with me that although life can become daunting at times, a gift she appreciates having received from her mother was the gift of faith. A gift that has been a tremendous help to her when she had to get herself through some very painful, challenging, and difficult periods in her life. So these experiences have been sort of working on me during the past year. The words that Lisa shared from the Apostle Paul's second letter to his younger helper and companion in the ministry, Timothy, you know, came to mind. In the opening words of this letter, Paul reflects upon how Timothy benefited from the training he had received from both his mother and before that, his grandmother. It's a powerful passage. I'm reminded of your sincere faith, the faith that dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and now I'm sure dwells in you. So I remind you, rekindle the gift of God that is within you through the laying on of my hands, for God did not give us a spirit of timidity, but a spirit of power and love and self-discipline. And these words can remind us of the valuable gifts that have been passed down to us across generations, including the gift of faith. Paul was certain this particular gift dwelt in Timothy, because he had seen it at work in Timothy's mother and then his grandmother's life before that. People from generations ahead of us, to the choices that they've made around how they would live their life, often the transmitters of gifts, including the gift of faith, to us. And I thought it would be good for us to remember this truth and to invite each other to take some time today to call to mind, bring to mind and heart those who have done this for us. Who are the individuals who helped pass on the gift of faith to you? Who are those people? Who were the transmitters of other additional gifts that have shaped and blessed your lives? Were they parents, grandparents, teachers, a
pastor or two, a neighbor, a mentor, a coach, another family member? Who are the people we're grateful for because they took an interest in us and took time to gently guide us and show us the way? Or perhaps they simply offered a power example through how they chose to live their lives, an example that inspired us to try to do the same. Who were the people who took time to care about us enough to do these things, who perhaps even saw things in us that we may have had a hard time seeing in ourselves? They may have done it intentionally through sharing their wisdom and training and commitment, experience, and gifts directly with us, or at other times, just as we watched them, how they chose to carry themselves, how they chose to immerse themselves within a caring community, and we were blessed by the witness of their lives. Now, the other side of this coin, and a question for us to consider, is who are the people God may be inviting us to mentor or pass on particular gifts to today? Who are the people we can take under our wing and help along their way? As others have done this for us, we too should be ready to offer what we can to those around us. That's how the gift keeps going. And it's not only a way for our faith to be passed on from generation to generation, or a way for others to benefit from our accumulated experience or wisdom, but it's also a way for our own faith and the own gifts that we have to stay alive and to stay vital within us. At some point in our lives, I mean, obviously we can do this throughout our lives at any age, but as we get older, at some point in our lives, a shift can take place where our focus isn't only on seeking out mentors and teachers and leaders and people who can share their gifts with us, but seeing how God is inviting us to offer these things to others. To share these things with those who are perhaps at a different point in their journey of life and faith. To share these things with those who might be newer to our own congregation. To share these things with those who are younger than us or have less experience than we do in a particular area. Who can benefit from the investment you and I make of taking them under our wings? We've done it in a variety of ways. We've heard multiple examples already this morning. Sometimes just inviting someone to join with us for worship, for Bible study, a prayer meeting, a hike, a visit to someone who's homebound or shut in. Take advantage of some service opportunity like singing in the choir, working with the senior advocates group, serving on a committee, helping with a thrift shop and furniture buyer, and so many other ways. The thing is, often we don't have to do too much. Just be the spark, the catalyst for this invitation. And then as one gets a little involved in the life of the community itself and the Holy Spirit does the rest. So I was working on this sermon. I was reminded of an article that I read earlier this year. It was first posted in the Harvard Gazette. I mentioned it a few months ago. The article is about a book someone wrote named Arthur Brooks, and he's a professor of management practice at Harvard Business School. This book is called From Strength to Strength, Finding Success, Happiness, and Deep Purpose in the Second Half of Your Life. That applies to most of us here today. In his book, Brooks examines the changes that take place in people's brains as we near middle age that make old ways of doing things less satisfying and effective. The book also charts a course to finding what he calls a second curve that can be more rewarding. Weaving stories of
high-achieving musicians and philosophers and religious leaders and scientists and athletes. The author points out research shows. This is good news, my friends. Research shows all things are not about decline past 40. Praise God. A key, however, to continuing to live rewarding lives as we get older is often found by shifting our focus from working hard at what we've been doing to sharing what we have with others, sharing what we've gained with others. It's been determined that certain aptitudes within us actually grow during middle age that favor things like wisdom and teaching and the sharing of ideas. So a key to aging well, according to Brooks, and living rewarding lives as we age is related to shifting these priorities, placing a greater emphasis on passing along what we have received, what we have learned, what we have gained and experienced to others for their benefit. This shift can take place in any area of our lives. With our family, with the church, work we do in the community, with our hobbies and interests, passing the gifts along. As we embrace this shift, we're not only helping those, we're welcoming, teaching, and mentoring, but we're also helping ourselves. So as we get ready for All Saints Day 1 week from today, and then later in the month, we celebrate Thanksgiving, right? It's a good time of year to be mindful of this dynamic. A good season to offer thanks for all the gifts that you and I have received through the attention and the support, the generosity, the kindness, the compassion, the love of others, and to reflect how can we continue to be good stewards of these gifts, which includes sharing what we have received with others and encouraging them on their journey of life and faith. Amen.
Amen.
Stand now and praise God for whom our blessings do come. soon all those around can warm up in its glowing. That's how it is with your love, O God. Once we've experienced it, we want to pass it on. So in thanks and in recognition of all the gifts you have shared and passed on to us, we offer our thanks and praise and offer these gifts and tithes and offerings. We ask that you would bless them and those who have given them, that they would be used to help pass on gifts of love and faith, your gifts with others. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Please be seated. This time in our service, we'd like to invite each other into a few moments of prayer and reflection. Ask that we remember those who are listed in our bulletin this week, requested our support in this way and in other ways. I know that there are others that we hold in our hearts, and also we want to take some time offering our thanks to God. So now in this period of shared silence, you know, bring to God at the altar of your hearts whatever prayers you might have, but set aside a little bit of time. I invite you to set aside a little bit of time to bring to mind and heart people who have blessed your life, people who have passed on important gifts to you to make you the people you are today. Right? People who shared their time, energy, experiences, love, and faith with us. Let's pause now and have this time of shared silence. Let us pray. God, as we recall those who passed on important gifts to us, we can be reminded of how fortunate we are to have had so many different people in our lives, people who have encouraged us and helped us grow, enabled us to come to know you better, helped us live out our faith more fully, helped us to love more completely. We're grateful for those who believed in us and showed us how to achieve things we didn't know we'd be able to achieve or do things we didn't know we'd be able to do. So many people in different ways over different periods of our life who have blessed us. We thank you, Lord. And as we continue to value people who have done and can continue to do these things for us, help us to also realize that you've given each of us opportunities to offer what we've received to share those things with others. May we continue to shift our focus when the time is right, and not only consuming what others have to offer us, but by sharing our time and energy, experience, love, and faith with those around us, so all can grow and flourish. Help us to see the opportunities you give us to do these things and not be afraid to embrace them. May we do what we can, not only for today, but also to assist future generations through the sharing and passing on of these gifts. We offer these things in the name of Jesus, who also taught us to pray when gathered together, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory of forever. Amen.
As we prepare to leave this place, remember there's a wonderful luncheon being offered for anyone who can stay. No reservation needed. Just go right into the parish hall here. There'll be people there to receive you. I'd like to offer a blessing on the meal and then a final good word. God, we thank you for your faithfulness expressed in so many ways, for all your good gifts, including the gift you've given us and each other. Thank you for the ministries we share through your church and the way we can touch, transform, and bless the lives of many through this gift. Thank you for the food that's been prepared for us, the work of those who are hosting this luncheon, for this additional time to be together. Bless the meal, we pray, and especially our life together in the coming weeks and months and year. May we continue to strive to be the people you are calling us to be. Amen.
Amen.
Now may the beauty of God continue to be reflected in the light of your eyes. And may the love of God always be reflected in the work and activity of our hands. May the wisdom of God be reflected in our choice of words. And the knowledge of God flow from your heart in such a way that others will see, and in seeing also believe. Amen.